Hello, everybody, and welcome to Hollywood Church today on this sunny Sunday afternoon. If there's any announcements for you today when I get done, if anybody has any further announcements, they're welcome to bring them to the floor of the church. The youth group will be meeting tonight in the new building from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. The Lord's Army, many youth kids group will be meeting each Friday night from 6 to 8 p.m. This is for kids age pre-K through 5th grade. If you would like to volunteer to help with this ministry, please see John or Tanisha. Then there's another announcement on, that one's the Mountain Pie one for the next many years.
Okay, this Friday they're having Mountain Pies and s'mores, and the parents are invited to stay with the kids, so we're going to have a fire outside and put some s'mores and Mountain Pies.
The fellowship team will be hosting a hunter's breakfast on Saturday, November 30th, beginning at 5 a.m. Come out for a full menu of food, including eggs, sausage, potatoes, sausage, gravy, and more. If you would like to help with this breakfast, please see a fellowship team member.
Right. We're going to pass around sign-up sheets for the items we need and for help. So okay. If people can help or want to bring something, please sign up.
Time's
going to start tomorrow.
Okay. We will only be having one service at 10:30 today and next week. There will be no Sunday school as well next Sunday. Pastor Doug will not be having regular office hours the next 2 weeks due to being on vacation. In case of emergency, please call his cell phone or contact a board member. A glow will meet tomorrow at the church at 10 a.m. Prayer time will be offered the next 2 Mondays. Anybody wanting to make a donation to the hurricane relief efforts can give a check to Linda Emhoff, made out to the Leatherwood Church with hurricane relief in the memo. All funds will be sent to the Mountain View Church of God in Clinton, North Carolina, which was pastored by Reverend Mike Hicks. Supper and study will be taking a break for the next 2 weeks. We will conclude the series on November 29th at 6 p.m. There will be a pancake and waffle breakfast here at Leatherwood on Sunday, November 10th at 9 a.m. All donations for the breakfast will be for the Lord's Army Kids Group and many youth programs. Come out and enjoy breakfast for a great cause. Release time is back for grades 6 through 12. Here is the schedule for November 7th, 6th grade, Distant Baptist, November 14th, 7th and 8th grade, Oakland, November 21st, 9th through 12th grade, at Leatherwood. We are focusing on 2 main mission trips to Romania, a work trip, April-May of 2025, a ministry trip, July of 2025. If you would like more info, please see Pastor Doug. Reverend Scott Corley will be preaching here at Leatherwood on Sunday, November 10th. We will have a combined service at 10:30. There will be no Sunday school that week either. We will be collecting new toys and gifts to be taken to families in North Carolina during the first 2 weeks of November. Stay tuned for drop-off times and locations. The last day to drop-off will be Sunday, November 17th. And we also have a meal train that we are doing for a member of our parish that's in the, what has been the 3 weeks worth of meals that they need help with. So,
there's a sign-up sheet on the back table back there. Shirley, do we have you grab that and pass it around? Is there people can sign up? But Julie Bernese fell off her horse and fractured some of the vertebrae in her back, and so she's on bed rest for the next 3 weeks. So if you can help out with that and help to take a meal, and they are gluten-free, so that is that is a concern with taking the meal. I think there's a little note back there as well, kind of explaining what they can and can't have as well. So we'll get that passed around.
couple more announcements. We've had a lot today. There's a Christmas Festival of Carols, 7 p.m. Sunday, December 1st, at Oakland Church of God. And here's the flyer. I'm sure we'll post that somewhere. Then we have this one right here for a Romanian class with a class schedule. This flyer here will also be posted, and I just seen in the back of the bulletin a big thank you to Sue Jeffers, our treasurer, who is stepping down and being co-treasurer from now on. So a big thank you to you, Sue, for all that you've done for us in this church as treasurer.
All right. Let's stand and greet someone around us this morning. Oh, wait. Tracy, I got an announcement. Also, anybody that would like to just bring money to me, you're welcome to do that. But let's stand and meet someone around here this morning.
Thank you.
us all up and allowing us to come here and glorify you, not only with this offering, but celebrating you today. And I hope that we do this in a manner that pleases you. Amen.
Amen.
My name is Sugu Obifanya. I am 11 years old. Many people say they love Jesus. Just because you go to church does not mean you are going to heaven. Through your greatest journey class, I know who Jesus Christ is. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is the one who came and died for our sins.
The Great Journey program has changed the life of the children that I taught. They now understand who Jesus is and how and why they should also go out there and let other people know about the love of Jesus.
I like the program because it changed my life. It teaches me that I should also be faithful and I should love one another. Through the greatest journey class, I cannot preach the word of God to my friends and others.
Since the area is a remote area, there is no churches, she puts upon herself, she goes around and preach to the children in the area. That's how come she met Daniel, the guy picking up scraps.
After the greatest journey class, I learned about evangelism and I saw them picking scrap passing by and I went and I came closer to him and I talked to him that why is it that he didn't go to school today, and he told me that he is supposed to pick scrap so that he go and sell and used to pay his school fees and used to eat. And I preached to him the gospel and I told him to accept Jesus Christ as his personal savior.
Because of what Epifania did by preaching to Daniel, Daniel and the whole family has become part of the church. And then it has really helped Daniel to change from how he was and how he is now.
Let the little children come to me. Don't keep them away. God's kingdom belongs to people like them. I am very happy for God has taken me to win souls like Daniel. I'm happy because we became friends and I want the world to know about Jesus Christ.
This is for my safety. I can do everything by the power of Christ. Give me strength. Amen.
She has won a soul for Christ. I told them when they do that, there is joy in heaven. Within a year, we have grown massively into a huge church. And it has impacted greatly on the life of the people in the area and on the life of my church.
Who knows? That one box may have come from this church. It went to that one girl that gave the greatest journey class who accepted Jesus Christ and now won another friend and who won other friends, and now they have grown this huge church in the middle of Africa. What a blessing and a legacy that is. And so that's why we do the every year the blessing of the boxes. We send them out from here. We have two more weeks left to go. We're still collecting. And I hope that you will do your part to send the gospel message around the world. The second thing from that video is kids make it look so easy, don't they? Just tell somebody about Jesus and what he's done for me. And that's kind of what we're going to be talking about today as we conclude our series on Jesus Praise. Go tell the world about me. If our job is to make God known. And so let's stand with that in mind and lift Jesus Christ on high. We want to see Jesus lifted high.
Okay, I have a little testimony I want to share, and I did not realize until Saturday when we were sitting here at the church board and gathered, and I had said something, and I'm like, you know what? I had never sat down and addressed the people of my church with this yet. Now, a lot of you guys know, and you know, you've heard the story, and I would tell people about how I ended up here over Tractor Sunday. You know, God woke me up that morning at 3:01 in the morning and said, look, you're not doing what you were doing. Go to Tractor Sunday. So, with that being said, that very day that I set foot on this church ground began one wild ride. And I'm going to tell you, this ride, you couldn't take a drug or a drink that would ever, ever duplicate what God has shown me, his power, his greatness, you know, everything that he had taken somebody at the point I stepped foot on this church grounds. I was broken. I was headed back up. I stepped on the church grounds. That day changed everything. So we'll try to keep this. We're not going to get into the real elaborate things with this, but anyways, after I stepped foot in this church the first night, I met John outside. John's telling me this story about this kid going to the bathroom on the playground out in the church. And I'm like, you know, so these people are as messed up at this church as I am. I think I found them. So I'm like, all right, you know, and it was 6 months down the road, and, you know, after Doug's gone, hey, we're going to have a baptism. You in? I'm like, yep, God told me to, let's do this thing. So I had to go home and read up on what a baptism was. So, you know, then, top this off, 2 weeks after I got, well, then I get attacked in the park by some evil forces, which that was kind of an enlightening thing, and that led to where I ended up 2 weeks after that. A buddy of mine called me up and he says, hey, says, I know your story with your drugs and stuff like that, and alcohol, and, you know, your past, he said, I need you to help me with something. This gentleman ran what was called Christians for Recovery. So I embarked on that journey 2 weeks after I was baptized, and that has been one wild ride ever since then as well. We've gone all over from Huntington County to anywhere in Pennsylvania to Ohio to, you know, going out and telling people basically that, you know, yes, rehab programs are wonderful, but there's one way you are going to stay sober, and that is to find Jesus Christ and put your rear end in a church seat. So, that was the last 2.5 years of my life. And I'll tell you what, this summer had gotten very hectic with that. Over 3 vehicles, I put on 60,000 miles from my birthday in February to this day. Now, I have 2 bigger trips, but what I want to share with you guys today is, you know, when the Lord comes to you and tells you to do something, do not fight it. Trust in Him. And why I'm telling you this is because when I started coming to church, I started having trouble, you know, keeping the job that I had. Because, well, the good Lord put the end to that one real quick over. Long story short, he knew I wasn't supposed to be there, so a couple of different occasions, even though him and I had a disagreement about speaking in tongues in front of my coworkers, I spoke in tongues twice, got 2 psychological evaluations from this. God pulled me through both of these, only to turn around when the opportunity came about. I started working for an organization called Hope International Ministries. And what they do is they open up Hope Centers. And what this is a center to help anybody from an abused woman to somebody suffering from drugs and alcohol to mental illness to homeless people. Now, these Hope Centers will pop up usually out of places where people will donate the property, like a defunct business that, you know, needs you know, a tax break to settle their books or whatnot. So I got involved with that organization, and God started speaking to me the minute that we did this. Red Hope Center, one of the primary purposes is, it is a church, but it is not a church. And why I say that is because if you have somebody that knows how to get state and federal money for people suffering from mental illness, drugs, and alcohol, you can use state and federal money to help these people and also provide them with the knowledge of Jesus and the experience of a church. So I got to meet several of the higher-ups from this Hope Center, and they are out of Las Vegas. So they had come one day, and they had come one day, and then they come another day, and they had started sending people to the Hope Centers that I was in charge of to find out what was going on there, why they were so successful. And I met several people from the headquarters of Hope International Ministry. Well, then God started again the same battle him and I had over, and I just learned not to even battle with him anymore. That's why I tell you, if God exposes your building, you just do it. We had a wrestling match over me becoming a member of the board of this church. He told me I needed to. I told him I didn't. We wrestled about for 2 weeks. Well, he came to me with, you know, I think you need to further your education, get an education in basically taking this book right here and teaching how people how to live out of this book and counseling them through it and preaching to them. So early summer, I was given a list and a couple short things to do. I had 45 books that I was required to read before I started my last class, and now I am back in school to, I'm going to become a pastor specializing in counseling to drug and alcohol addicts. And as I look back on this journey, you know, I realize that this was why God saved me. So if you're unsure why God is saving you, why you are sitting here today, put your faith in Him. Find something you can reach out to people in the world. It doesn't necessarily have to be a church activity, but God will help you find your way if you let Him. That was one of my biggest things, was I fought with things that God would tell me to do. And, you know, a lot of it was, you know, a lot of those pre-looming things from, you know, alcoholism, which was I didn't feel like I was worthy. You know, how many of us throughout life have not felt like we were worthy? You know? And then you sit there, you come to church, you have a sense of purpose, God gives you a direction, and, you know, I'm going to tell you, I've never been happier in my life, and it makes me happy to have a church family like you guys, and, you know, the support that I have received from everybody is just incredible. And like I said, I just wanted to share that testimony and say a big thank you to everybody along the way that has helped me, that has believed in me, that has supported me. And you are all loved. Thank you.
A time of prayer, but it's going to be a little different today. Today for prayer, we are going to be praying for our country and our election. And I want you to know two things off the bat. Number one, you should vote on Tuesday. There's no excuse. I've heard them all. I don't care if you don't like to talk to people, there are people on there, and if you don't like any of the people on the ballot, you are allowed to check the box and write in any name that you want to in that last box, in that last line. So if you can find one person that you believe in, vote for them right then. But go vote on Tuesday. The second thing is, we've been stressing far too long over this stupid election. And so, Kim's going to play the song, I Surrender All. And through this prayer time, we're going to surrender the events of this week into His hands. We are going to trust that the Lord's will is going to be done, and that He is going to bring us through, and we're going to do our part. We're going to vote on Tuesday, and we're going to seek the Lord in everything and surrender to Him. So we're going to have a time of silent prayer at your seats, or if you'd like to come up front and bow at the altar, you can do that. But we're going to pray as Kim is playing through the song and singing through the verses. And it may be a little extended time, so you can just play some quietly. But let's lift up this time, our country, this election, and just, I see far too many people carrying it around inside. Just let it off, put it in the hands of God, and let Him take control. All right? Let's pray together.
Thank you.
this declaration that no matter what happens on Tuesday, there's 100% chance that Jesus Christ will be Lord.
Amen.
That's a certainty. You can take that to your bank. So don't be afraid. Don't be scared. Do your part. And trust the Lord with all your heart. I know a number of people have been asking me, well, will you give an endorsement for president? No. But if you want to know who I'm voting for, just ask me. I'll let you know and how I came to the decision. It may not be the same to you because we're all different. You have different reasons. You have different reasonings. You have different ways of looking at the world than other people do, and that's okay. But if you want to know, just ask me. I'll share why I came to my decision this time, because it was not an easy one. And so let's go out and be show Christ to the world this week. The world needs it. All right, kids, you are dismissed to children's church at this time. Got lucky. Put the new battery in the clock and it worked. So it was stuck at a time where I thought I had more time. No matter, if I would have been preaching, I would have looked up and been like, oh, I got 5 more minutes left. And so I would have done that for like a half hour and you guys looked in here forever. But looks like the clock has been repaired and is working. So we are going to be wrapping up our Jesus Praise series. And last week we talked about the fact that as Jesus was closing up his words of prayer to the Father, and as he was praying over his disciples and the believers in general, he was giving them a promise that I want you to be with me where I am. And so the way to be with Jesus where he is was through prayer. And the way to see him in his glory was through prayer. But however, he didn't just end his words with these words of promise. He also gave the disciples that were there and the believers that would come after them a purpose as well. And we read that, and we're going to be reading the same scripture as last week, John 17, verses 24 through 26. So John 17, verses 24 through 26. He says, Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me, because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you. And they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known, in order that the love that you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. You know, as I read over these words over the last couple of weeks, this one phrase just kept standing out to me. I have made you known to them. And that's Jesus speaking to the Father, Jesus saying, I, Jesus, have made you, the Father, known to them, the disciples. And so that was Jesus' entire purpose almost for being here on the earth, was to make God known to people that needed to know about God. And so because of this, we also, as his believers, have this same mantra on our life that we need to make God known to the world, because we have Jesus Christ living within us. And it's the whole reason, really, why we're here on this earth, is to make Jesus, make the Father, make the Holy Spirit, make God in three parts known to the world around us. You know, as I look at these words, we see John wrapping up his prayer here, and he makes this part of our purpose clear.
And this is not just a one-time thing here in this prayer to make God known to the world. This is something that he almost ends every book of the scriptures in that Jesus is in. So every time Jesus shares last words, he talks about making God known and witnessing to the glory and preaching to all of creation. And so we have a mission to be a witness to God and what he can do. And we're told this in all four gospel accounts and the book of Acts. And so I want to read those to you. Matthew 28, verses 19 through 20, the very last words of the book of Matthew as it's coming to a close. We shared this the last 2 weeks, but it's important. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. So how do we make them disciples? We teach them what we know about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. The end of Mark 16. Mark 16 is the last chapter in Mark. In verse 15, it says this. He said to them, this is his disciples, go into all of the world and preach the gospel to all creation. What is the gospel? It's telling them who God is and what he has done for them through his Son, Jesus Christ. John 20, verse 21. This is the next to last chapter in the book of John. He's talking with his disciples. It says, Luke. Luke 24, last chapter of Luke. It says, then he opened their minds so that he could understand the scriptures, and he told them, this is why it's written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance of the forgiveness of sin will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are my witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in that city until you've been clothed with power from on high. And I know that says Mark 24, that's why he's saying it's Luke 24, where he says this. John 20, 21, it says, and Jesus said, peace be with you, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And then in Acts 1, 8 through 9, as Jesus is getting ready to go up into heaven, he says to the disciples, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And after he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and the cloud hid them from their sight. As followers of Jesus Christ, we must focus on two things that must be put forth first. Number one, you are sent by God for a purpose. Do you believe that? You are sent by God for a purpose. You are not here by accident. And number two, that purpose is to be a witness for God and to make him known. So number one, you're sent by God for a purpose. And number two, that purpose is to witness about God and make him known. So, when should you talk to someone about Jesus if you are a believer?
Anytime.
The answer is yes. Okay? The answer is yes. If you are a believer and you have Jesus Christ in your heart, you should be talking about him. Because, and we make these excuses all the time, but I want you to think about this. Number one, there is never a bad time to share your testimony. If you have those thoughts of doubt and fear going through your mind, well, I don't know if it's the right time to share, if it's the right... It's the right time because you have been sent for this. There's never a bad time to share your testimony. Also, there's not a person that doesn't need to hear about Jesus. Right? What better words could you give them than talking about Jesus Christ and the answers that he has? So there's not a person that doesn't need to hear about him. And also, there's not a place where his light shouldn't shine through your words. And as I thought about this, I began to think of my own life. How often do I share my testimonies about what God has done for me and continues to do for me on a daily basis? You know, I do have an hour. I get to preach every Sunday pretty much. You know, so I'm like, well, God, I make you known through these things, right? But that's my job. That's not my calling. My purpose, my calling is the job. The purpose is I need to make Jesus known to everyone at every time. And so this morning I thought I'd just share with you some of my personal stories about what God has done for me. And I'm going to trust that some of you have gone through these same things, and some of you are going through these things right now, and you need to know if Jesus is going to come through for you. You know, I first became a believer at a church camp at Whitehall, Camp and Conference Center in Edmonton, PA. I think it was the summer after my fifth grade year. I attended camp there for the first time. And up until that time, my family attended church probably less times than they should have. In fact, we weren't in church as many times as we were in church. But I signed myself up for camp because it sounded fun. And our church paid most of the way there, so my parents couldn't complain too much about it. And so I found myself at church camp as someone who knew a little bit about God, but never knew God. And so as I sat there in the tabernacle, one of the first times that I had ever sat up there in that tabernacle, I'm like, man, who gave this guy a book to my life? Like, as he's preaching, it's like he was talking directly to me, and I didn't know at the time that that's the Holy Spirit pricking your conscience. And so, as he asked if there was any that wanted to come forward to accept Christ, with tears in my eyes, I ran to the altar, and an adult there led me to Jesus, and a relationship with him as a fifth grader. You know, when we are in church, or we're in our cars, or we're in our showers, and we get that prick to our heart, we can't ignore it. Because it's Jesus trying to get our attention. You know, after I became a Christian, I began to attend church more regularly. Everything was going pretty well, and up through my seventh grade year. And about halfway through our seventh grade year, my dad told me to come and to sit down with him. He said that we needed to talk. He told me that he was leaving our family and that I would have to be the man of the house now. I was 13. To make matters worse, I broke my leg in school that year and had to finish my seventh grade year in traction for 5 weeks in Clarion Hospital with my leg hanging from the ceiling. What a way to spend your seventh grade year, let me tell you. And if that wasn't even bad enough, the whole summer I got to wear a body cast. That's awesome. So that was an extremely hard time. No father. No way to get around, laying in a bed. But as a seventh grade boy, I can tell you I understood why they called God the Good Father. Because he was there for me. Every day, every hour, every time I needed him. And so after I got out of the body cast at our first youth meeting at Prince Glitz and State Park, I decided I'm going to be baptized. And so I got baptized before I entered my eighth grade year. Because God was there as my father in the lowest times. You know, through high school, I found many of my closest friends in the church youth group, and really they kept me out of so much trouble. Because we would push each other to be better Christians, and we would help each other any way that we could. And, you know, it's really awesome to see there was about 20 regular people that came to our youth group. And I think that there's 6 of us that are now in full-time ministry. That's impressive. I don't know what they were doing in that youth group, but they were doing something correctly. And God had his hand on me, even in preparing my life for ministry while I was in high school. And he allowed me the ability, they let me teach VBS as like a 14-year-old. What church does that? Except every church. If you say yes, yes, you get the chance to do it. And I got to lead the Bible club and do these things that helped to shape me. God was shaping me to be a minister at a very early age. But as I went into my college years, I lost contact with many of these friends because, like, we didn't have cell phones, we didn't have social media. Several of the other friends were younger than I was and didn't have cars, and so we didn't have a way to stay connected. And so I tried to get involved in a campus ministry, but it didn't really work with my college schedule. And so then God sent a man named Todd Cravens into my life. Todd showed me what a mentor was. Todd himself was a college student who was studying to be a minister, but he was doing an internship at Lock Haven University, and so he was our leader of our college ministry, and he didn't take no for an answer. When you asked him, when he said, "Hey, are you coming on Tuesday night?" I said, "No, I have this." "No, you don't. This is important." He was right there nudging me, mentoring me, giving me ministry roles at the university and at the church. And I grew more in my faith in 9 months of my sophomore year than I ever had up until this point. He taught me the importance of reading the scriptures and knowing them as well. And Jesus sent him to me. He lived in Kentucky. He had no business being at Lock Haven University whatsoever. And in fact, he did go back to Kentucky to finish his college degree. And so he left me a part of the ministry at the university in charge of part of it. And things went well for most of this year. I had a steady and godly girlfriend. Things were looking up. And as the junior year came to a close and we were talking about getting married, she came to me and told me she wanted to break up. It broke my heart, and I went off the deep end, and I turned to partying and drinking and not caring about anyone or anything. In fact, I was lost. I wanted nothing to do with church at all. I literally stumbled into my senior year of college, like literally, and I couldn't wait to get it over so I could move to Hawaii and really live it up. I don't know why I wanted to go to Hawaii, but that sounded like a great place to be for the party scene. And after not attending church for a couple of months, one older gentleman named Art Gray, who was on our church board, and he was dean of science at the university, and Art was not a little guy. Would you say Art is probably like 7'4 and 400 pounds? Like, he is a massive individual. He's not really that big. I love you, Dr. Gray. But he looks like a massive individual. And so he said, "I want you to come into my office." And you look at him and you say, "Yes, sir." When he speaks to you. And as I walked into his office on the campus of Lock Haven University, he took me aside and he said, "Doug, it's time to come home. God loves you. He never hurts you. He loves you so much." And it broke me. And I confessed and repented right there in his office. That the people walking by must have thought this was quite a scene. But I submitted myself to learning from him and letting him teach me how not to fall away again. God found me again in my lowest place, and I can really, when the prodigal son comes running home and the father wraps his arm around him, I can say that's completely, completely true. From that time on, things completely turned around for me. As a matter of fact, Todd Craven's returned to the university. He had graduated. He was back there. He was leading me and guiding me. And he said to me, he called me one day and he said, you know, I have three kids under the age of four. I'm not able to do as much as I once did while, when we were here before. But he said, I want you to help me. And I'm going to show you how to become a minister. And I was like, I got a teaching degree, I've got teaching classes to do, I'm a substitute teacher at this district and here. And he said, no, you are a minister. You're going to be a minister. And so he showed me how to do personal devotions, quiet times. I went to multiple Bible studies a week. I went out and shared my faith for the first time. I'd walk around campus and just tell people about Jesus. And that's kind of what we got to get back to in life. I got kicked out of the Student Union Center for praying over people at a secular concert once. A security guard came over to me, and as all of the people were wearing their black leather and pierced everywhere and rocking out to rock music, he came over to me and he said, you're making people feel uncomfortable. Okay. And that is when our campus ministry exploded. We went from just a handful of people each week to having nearly 100 in attendance in the matter of a couple of weeks. I met my wife, and she's one of the new people that began to attend at that time. And I didn't have anything to do with it. God knit it together. I just followed his path. You know, there's one more dark time I have to tell you about. Because it shows God's faithfulness. You know, it wasn't long after I told my dad that I was going to marry this girl that I was dating. He told me he had cancer. And he fought it hard. But the disease and the medicine took its toll on him. And one day he bent down in the living room and his back literally broke in five places. They didn't want to do surgery right away because they were afraid he was too weak from the cancer treatment. So they waited until they thought it was safe to operate. They fixed the back injury and my dad was feeling great. I spoke to him on the phone. He got up. He's like, son, this is so awesome. There's no pain. I hung up the phone with him. I said, that's great, Dad. I said that I was going to go to come home and see him that weekend. And that night he went to bed and never woke up again. Despite all my success in getting college students and my friends to follow Jesus, my dad was the one egg I couldn't crack. He was a hard man towards religion. And he even kicked me out of his hospital one day for trying to tell him about Jesus. And this was only a few months before he passed away. And despite not knowing what was going on with him, because we lived 2 hours apart at this time, God did something for me. The night before he died, I didn't know it was going to be his last night, but I went to bed laughing. And I have no idea why, because I had never done that before, and I've never done it to this day again. But I went to bed at complete peace. The Lord stilled my soul and brought joy. And I woke up the next morning early to the sound of your phone ringing. You know exactly when the phone rings in the early in the morning that it's probably something not good. And before I answered, I knew instantly because the Holy Spirit said, they're calling about your dad. And it's not good news. And so I answered the phone. My Aunt Diane said that he was in a coma in Pittsburgh, which is about 3.5 hours away. And I was to come immediately. I knew in my spirit he would not wake up. But I was still, the whole time, the whole drive to Pittsburgh, at complete peace. I drove 3.5 hours alone, and God was bringing peace. At the funeral, Rick Burford came and spoke to me. He said, "Did your dad tell you what he did?" And I said, "No, I don't think so." And Rick said, "Well, I went to your dad's hospital room a couple weeks ago, and I told him about what Jesus did for me. And he said, your dad shed a tear, and I led him in a prayer to ask Jesus into his heart." There it was. That was the peace. Even though I didn't know it happened, God showed me it did happen. God answered hundreds of prayers. Literally hundreds of prayers that I prayed as a kid to the day that he died for the salvation of my dad. And I tell you, what an awesome Savior he is. You know, since this time, I've seen him move so awesomely. Like, he blessed me with the perfect spouse. He absolutely did. He blessed me with three kids that I've come to see, come to the Lord and be baptized. I've seen him bring the hardest people to their knees to profess the Lord. And I'm telling you, there have been hard times, there have been good times, but God has brought me through every one. And it's not because I'm special, but it's because he is. So I want to share with you my life verse. As I'm getting ready to close, as much as possible, as far as you know, I'm almost done. Philippians 4:19. "And my God will meet all of your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus." I'm telling you, every word of that is true. I've seen it in my life. I've experienced it. And I can tell you, when there's $2.47 in your account and you still have a month until payday, my God will supply all of your needs. When you are in need of a father and don't have a father, God will be your father. When you need a miracle and you don't know how you're going to get through, let me tell you, my God will meet all of your needs according to the riches that are in Christ Jesus. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. But I'm also making it known, because that's what we're supposed to do. So what is your story? What is your story? Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for your faithfulness. Lord, I thank you that you're not just a Savior on the pages of the Bible, but you're a Savior in real life. Every time I've needed it, you've saved me. Lord, I thank you that you're a provider, that you comfort in our darkest times and bring that light and joy and peace. Lord, help us to make our stories about you known, so that you can be known in the world that needs to hear about you. We thank you and we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I want to close with the video, and while we're closing with this song, I want you to bring up a few names in your head. Ask the Lord to give them to you about who you can tell about Jesus Christ, about God the Father and the Holy Spirit this week. So watch this.
Yeah.